This is the OTB Television Network, a service of Capital District Off-Track Betting.
Broadcasting live from the backstretch at Saratoga, this is the Handicapper's Report.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Handicapper's Board, coming to you live from the backstretch at Saratoga Racecourse on what I think can only fairly be called a glorious, glorious Monday morning. It is sunny, blue skies out there at 9 o'clock in the morning. It is breezy, a little chilly, but a beautiful, beautiful day as we are in the wake of a big weekend at Saratoga. First on Saturday afternoon, tremendous racing at the highest level, grade ones and grade two. Then yesterday, a very big day for the New York Bred Style, about a handful of stakes races, but place is probably still abuzz from a couple of items. One is VE Day, the other Jimmy Jerkins horse and Javier Castellano, who had a couple quiet days and then just lighted up the board over the weekend, but they get home in an upset victory, paying over $40 in the Traverse Stakes. Artemis Agritera, who might have put in physically the performance of the day, just demolishing the grade one ballerina. And congratulations to the Bromans, who have been around a long time and have dedicated much of their resources to the New York Bred program, and I think aptly rewarded on Saturday afternoon. And as Brian Edo and I talked about on Saturday, I just knew the big beast was going to be my unwinding. And luckily, as I have gotten older in the game, I was comfortable on sliding Fast Anna under. When I saw the half mile pole, I was relieved, because I really felt at that time either my big exacta was in or my saver exacta was in, because I thought the talent of the big beast could overrun the advantage that Johnny V had been given by the field in the King's Bishop. Fast Anna ran well in the third career starts. Two horses coming out of entry level allowance, run 1-2. In the King's Bishop, but Strathnaver doesn't win the Boston Spa, which I needed her to win. Falimbi ran awful at 3-5.
Zero excuse.
Bayern, the 2-1 favorite in the Travers that I had nowhere on my radar, doesn't beat a horse.
Yeah, he ran. I picked him eighth. He ran worse than I thought. So.
Eighth.
Yeah, the big beast, and I was on this show. We did this show together, and I said the horse cannot lose, and I outsmarted myself almost. He opened at 7-2, and I said, "What the heck?"
He finished at 5-2. The money line odds, which we couldn't believe. We thought he'd be a high five to two,
and I guess in hindsight, it was all the money. And it's always easy after the fact, but Wildcat Red opened at 8-5, and I'm just thinking, who is
and did not run well
betting this horse down there at 8-5? But the big beast really had to earn it, because, like you said, your pick, Fast Anna, when. And I was doing the bankroll that day. When I saw 46 flat, I thought two things. A, that's impossible. B, three things. B, that's the slowest half mile ever in the King's Bishop. And C, this horse might not come back to the field. Because for the caliber of horses that he is, now we know he is, and you felt he was, he couldn't have possibly run any slower in that type of spot. And he ran his heart out. He ran a winning race. He just got nipped by a horse that I think is a better horse.
Better animal.
Also had a little seasoning edge, a race over the track. So, I mean, Fast Anna was terrific.
Now we bring in Matt Grace. Matt, good morning.
Good morning, guys.
Good morning, Matt.
How are you today?
Well, not too bad after the last race yesterday. It was a little discouraging, and then we got the Brooklyn horse home in the last race yesterday, and it kind of soothed some of the wounds from the previous races.
Well, as you know, Matt, isn't that sort of the nature of the game for us?
Yeah, you just need one, It's like that one good golf shot,
That's what I tell people. Well, usually you need more than one good golf shot. In this game, you go 1-for-10 and walk out of here the happiest person the racetrack. But, Matt, just want to I didn't work yesterday morning, but any thoughts coming out of the weekend going forward? I don't know if you had a chance. I know it was about 8 o'clock, after 8 o'clock our time, if you got a chance to see Shared Belief, the three-year-old, get in some traffic trouble. And look, I thought, once again, brilliant taking on Elders for the first time in the Pacific Classic.
Yeah, I did stick around for that race because I really wanted to see how Shared Belief would run. And boy, this is a real good horse, I'll tell you. And what a tremendous training job to come back off that kind of a layoff and be able to put in a performance like that at the top of the, you know, at the top of the heap in the California. And I mean, it was just incredible. That horse came off the track looking so good. I don't think I've ever seen a horse look so good after running that far.
Matt, we were talking before the show. I hope people have had a chance to see him, because we were saying that if you saw his Los Al Derby, he was awesome in so far his only dirt performance, and then he followed it up. And what I liked about yesterday, Matt, for him, you know, he had trouble at the start. You know, he veered out, missed the start, hit the gate, I think the charts say, yeah, and was, you know, spun out. He was the outside post position. But he showed a lot of maturity. The foul claim I didn't think was a big deal. I didn't think there was much there.
A lot of little grandstanding.
Yeah,
there,
I think Victor Espinosa was taking a shot. And then, as you said, he finished up the race, and you were like, oh, man, what's the bottom for this horse? And I just hope, I just don't know if it got a – it's tough, Matt, on the East Coast when there's a Sunday night in almost the 9 o'clock hour, big-time spot. But I have to tell you, I think he is the most talented three-year-old colt. I'm not saying he deserves a championship yet, but I'll tell you one thing. If they do meet head-to-head, I'm not going to be thinking twice about who I would bet, because I thought, as you mentioned, that was a big-time performance by a three-year-old taking on their elders in the middle part of summer for Shared Belief.
Yeah, I think, you know, I don't know if he's going to run two more times or if he's just going to go to the Classic, but I'd like to see him run once more and then in the Classic.
He did mention, Matt, that Jerry did mention that he thinks there will be one more start, so he would maybe surmise the awesome again at Santa Anita. But
okay, well, that'll be good. I feel sorry for the horses that run against him in that one.
He is, you know, he's the real deal. And you know, Matt, having covered the Triple Crown for so many years, when a three-year-old colt misses the Triple Crown, boy, they you know, you think about Tiz Now is about the only one in modern times. How much work you got to do to get back in the picture? But I am of the opinion that he's close enough now to California Chrome that he can win the three-year-old championship without participating really in the Triple Crown preps or the Triple Crown races. And, Matt, I don't think that happens too often.
No, it doesn't. But you're right. I mean, if he does run the table from here, and if California Chrome happens to be, you know, the victim in either one or two of those races, then I don't see how he's going to be denied. I don't think we have anything to compete with him on the East Coast. But
right, and not only that, too, California Chrome will run in the Breeders' Cup Classic having not run against older horses. Shared Belief,
exactly,
assuming he runs in the Awesome again, will, and then wins the Breeders' Cup Classic, we're looking into the future,
we'll
have three grade one wins against older horses. That's a no-brainer to me.
It was, and I think on the East Coast, Matt, and I'll ask you safely say that there's no chance that Tonalist, who's a Classic winner, or even Wicked Strong, that they can win a three-year-old championship. It just can't be done. I don't think.
No, especially because it doesn't look like they're eyeing the Pennsylvania Derby. So you can't avoid California Chrome and somewhat back into it. I agree.
Right, right. Exactly right.
All right. Matt, it's a beautiful Monday wrapping up Travers Week. What do you have for the folks?
Okay, let's go to race 9. Smart and Fancy. You remember that one, I'm sure, Anthony.
Yes.
You remember all of these.
I remember some of them. I do seem to remember a lot of them.
I'd like a horse in here quite a bit, number 8, Free as a Bird. I'm just looking at a horse that is just a professional turf sprinter. I normally don't like these turf sprints, but just the way Free as a Bird runs it in the hands of Joel Rosario, this horse always seems to get the job done. I think there's plenty of speed in the race. I think other horses are going to be bet. There's some fashionable newcomers here, like Keith or Quay or however you want to pronounce it. And there's, you know, you have the old Stars Above Me and White Sangria, and you've got some really, you know, good turf sprinters in here. But I think when all is said and done, Mr. Rosario, who owes me one for the Travers and for the pick 4 that I almost had, I think Mr. Rosario will get the job done today with Bria's Other.
All right, Matt taking a shot at the 9th race this afternoon. The second feature.
Pretty good
of the
running,
race.
Too. We know.
Grade One kicking off Monday after the reschedule. Matt, you kind of made an allusion to what was your level of surprise as they went under the line the first time in the Travers and Joel Rosario was just about to put his nose in front of Byern?
I was, as I said yesterday to the guys, I was totally baffled by what he was trying to do with Tonalist. It looked to me like, you know, as you say, you know, sometimes you're handicapping, it looks like a defensive play. And I think that there was so much concern over the speed of Byern that it was in the heads of too many trainers and too many jockeys. And I think that was a reaction to Byern. And I think it was a wrong strategy, and I think it might have cost Tonalist the race.
All right. I mean, it was surprising. I think you weren't alone there. Matt, have a great Monday. We'll talk to you Wednesday.
Take care, Matt.
Okay, guys. Have a great day.
You know what I didn't understand from Joel Rosario, and I love him, and I've never ridden a horse, but I've said this. I would have thought that it would be just as effective, worried about Byern, a length off him mm-hmm. as on him.
Right.
I mean, just to let him know that I'm not going to let you get too far,
right.
too soft away, and I have enough speed that even if I think you do, I can go that. Yeah. It would have been just as effective if I say, you know, I'm right over here in your
right.
rear view mirror. But
and I said on the show, and this what didn't necessarily surprise me. I thought drawing outside of Byern, the fact that maybe outside the big three, we'll call them, I didn't think there was a lot in the race, or at least maybe the jockeys said, you know, this is the horse to beat. I expected Tonalist to put early pressure on him, but I agree with what you're saying in that maybe I thought he'd be a length off, not right there, but I did think he would. I don't. You know what? A great ride. One of the most underrated rides of my memory was John Velasquez on Flower Alley in the 2005 Travers, when he squeezed Bellamy Road just a little bit on the backside and said, "You know what? I'm right here. You're not going anywhere." And it caused Javier to have to go a little bit on Bellamy Road, and I think it won him the race. I kind of thought that would happen on Saturday, in that I'm right here, like you said, and we're not letting you get loose. But I'm not going to sit here and say I thought they'd be dueling through 47-1.
And I thought Wicked Strong would be in front of Tonalist.
I didn't, just because of the draw.
Okay.
Just because of the draw. He stacked three wide. You know, he'd have to be urged pretty good to get over and in front. But, you know,
you
I didn't.
Right in that regard.
Yeah, I didn't see it going that fast and pressing. I will admit that.
That shocked. And and at the end of the day, I think Wicked Strong was better than Tonalist.
I agree 100%
anyways,
with that.
And I just had the wrong horse coming out of the curling because I like Charge Now was my second pick, and
right.
it was the wrong horse. Was,
right.
You
know, and I played Viva Mallorca, and I was very shocked that the curling horses were ignored that much, that there was that much of a discrepancy. Charge Now, I want to say, was 30. Viva Mallorca, who was a little bit of an outsider, he was 30, and VE Day was 19.
Yeah.
I mean, complete.
I thought this was a even though we had the big two in Byern, and they on headline news, they seem to be. I thought the curl was good enough
yeah,
this year.
It wasn't like
I just got the wrong
right,
one.
Right, it wasn't like they were 10 lengths faster than the curling on paper. It wasn't like that at all.
No, it is. We take a quick break when we come back. 10 on Monday, including the Grade 1 Turf Riders.
I'm Brian Natto of HorsePlayerNow.com. Did you know that each Monday during the Saratoga Racing Meet, all Capital Bets account holders can earn an additional 1% in their player rewards program when wagering on Saratoga races? For more information, log on to CapitalOTB.com.
Summer at Saratoga, and there's no better place to watch all the racing action than right here on OTB-TV. Each morning, the Handicappers Report brings you selections and analysis from our professional handicappers. Then stick around as the biggest names in racing join us live from the backstretch. The top trainers, jockeys, and racing personalities all share their unique insights and observations. For more than 20 years, there's been just one place to turn for unparalleled coverage of the Saratoga Racing Meet, Capital OTB and OTB-TV.
1922, Babe Ruth debuts with the Yankees. WGY signs on air. Exterminator wins the Saratoga Cup, and Pinnell's Restaurant opens its doors for the very first time. For five generations, Pinnell's has been preparing delicious Italian food served in a comfortable home-like setting where everyone is welcomed. 92 years of authentic Italian recipes made with the freshest ingredients, and 92 years of the finest classic Italian dishes, all made daily by hand. Pinnell's Italian Restaurant, a Saratoga dining tradition since 1922.
Face it. Most horse racing websites are just too much. Too much clutter. Too much to navigate through. Next time, log on to CapitalOTB.com. Our newly designed website is easier than ever to use, with all the information the professional horse player needs. CapitalOTB.com.
He would be an offer.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Handicapper Sport, coming to you on a beautiful Monday morning live from the backstretch at Saratoga. Time to wrap up. Travers, we give a 10-race card. The New York Turf Riders becoming the second hurdle event of the meet to be rescheduled. It has been, in my entire lifetime, their premier steeplechase race of the meet. I can remember for a while there in the 80s, it was run the day before the Travers on a Friday afternoon. This year it's going to be run 2 days after the Travers. In the opener, they will go 2 3/8 miles, or about 2 3/8 miles.
Come on now. 5, 6, 7 for me and the Turf Riders. I've mentioned many times, as I've done the show on Wednesdays and Thursdays, weight is a big deal in these races.
Okay.
Pleasant Woodman drops 8 pounds. He gets some weight from his rivals. I don't necessarily know if handicapping this race like it's a flat track race is smart or not, but this horse is just loose as can be. On the lead, he tired to be third in the Smithwick earlier in the meet, but he stretches out here, second off a layoff for Doug Fout, a friend of mine, and I'm glad they got, finally, it's Doug Fout in the form, not, it used to be Paul, who was his dad.
Yeah.
Trained some very good horses. Cole Star comes to mind. So I'll go Pleasant Woodman on top in a little bit of an upset underneath the 6 altogether for Jack Fisher, who's, you know, usurp Jonathan Shepard as the sports championship trainer. In third, Demonstrative, who's got tons of back class. Woke up a bit in the Smithwick, but now he's spotting weight at 154. And I'll mention, I didn't pick Jonathan Shepard in here, and I should have did a little more homework, but I'm pretty sure Jonathan's won this race 13 times, which is beyond remarkable. So you leave him off at your own peril. But I'll go 5, 6, 7 in the Turf Riders.
I have no opinion, but if he's right about dropping weight, I'm dropping 16 pounds. I don't know if that's good. 2B, 6, 7.
All right, we will move on to the second, and I think it's worth noting, it appears at least, that the pick five will start in the first today. This is not... because we have a 1 at 1 p.m. post. We don't have the 12:25 like they were doing. So the pick five will start in the first. So the second will start us in the early pick four. 3 and up, State Breds. It's a 1X going 6 furlongs on the main track in a really sharp race.
That'll be interesting, because the other day when they rescheduled the jump, didn't they start at 1 o'clock?
They did
the pick start, the second race.
I thought that was 12:25. I'm not positive on that. I'm just wondering if they're giving this the grade one that it is, a historic race, a little more due. But
very nice.
I do have the DRF stats here, and it says pick five. So
okay.
Something to look into.
It's a fluid game.
Yeah,
we'll find out.
Right?
Don't believe everything you read or hear.
If they don't let you hit pick five at about 12:55 on your wagering menu, then there's no pick five. How about that?
A 2, 6, 7 for me. Swell for Peter Pugh. A very good horseman sends out this runner. Makes the first start since coming out of the Mike Lee, which is the first leg of the New York Triple. We just ran the final leg of it, so we missed the rest of it. Chris DiCarlo, a very good Eugene Jersey. Todd Fletcher's runners over there. He's come into New York. He's had a very good beat, I think, for second. Going to the outside, making the second career start for Bruce Brown. Number 6, Giant in the Moonlight. And for third, the 7, Mark Henning's runner. First time versus winners at the break in the maiden in the second start. Very impressively. 2, 6, 7. By the way, just see how good was who were you most impressed by yesterday?
I thought
Upstart.
Upstart coming back on 9 days and running down and a very, very good horse.
And the way he did it. We talked about shared belief every that was good.
Yeah, that was Upstart. Good. 9 days rest. The leader for Mike
he's only
Marina.
The second horse to come back and win.
That quick
off of that short of layoff.
Okay. Yeah, I mentioned it after the race, and I'm glad to see Rick Violet was paying attention to me. He didn't say the champagne is up next, so
okay.
Yeah, so I think then that's a good spot for the horse. Why not? Take a shot. It's a one-turn mile now, you know, at Belmont.
It was
worthy
nice,
of a shot.
Nice thing to watch.
Yeah, 7-6-2 for me. Same horses, a little different order. I was blown away by Qantos early in the meet. Anthony mentioned facing winners for the first time. That's always tricky on these blowout special weight winners. I like the post today. Mark Hennig, this is his only winner on the meet, but his horses have been pretty live. Underneath Giant in the Moonlight, who was equally impressive drawing off in his career debut at Belmont, but hasn't been seen since. And Swell is the obvious main danger, if not the horse to beat. And he's tackled winners. He's tackled Captain Sirius a few times, Empire Dreams, Sam Rat. So there's no knocks here. Maybe just needs a little bit of a pace meltdown to get up at six. But maybe the best 1X New York bred of the meet. I don't know. This is loaded to me. These top three are good horses.
The third race on the card this afternoon will be on the turf sprinting 5.5. Optional claimers in for 62. Capital C, and I'm pretty sure what this is going to get down to is typically the 62 in open companies, non-winners of two, other than, but there has to be a third condition in this race, which is why it's slash capital C versus the 2X.
Okay, good, yeah.
Twice over claimer, state bred, 913 race.
I think that's right.
Yeah, no. I mean, so that's why it's not a typical 2X.
4-2-7 for me for Indian Splendor. Oddly, Anthony, I didn't see a lot of pure turf sprint speed like we've, you know, accustomed to in these races. Now, I don't know if that puts Indian Splendor loose, but if nothing else, she's going to be right outside the inside speed if there is any. Jason Service, 29% in turf sprints. She's probably the best horse, probably goes favored in here. I had a tough time beating her, especially off a fine second. Down at Monmouth against Juju Eyeballs, who'd probably be 3-5 in here. She's a very, very sharp filly. Underneath number two, Magical Moon, and I mentioned there's not a lot of speed. I think she could be a lot closer today off a no-show, basically, early. No, at Churchill, Rosie Napravnik re-rides, comes back, and I think she should be showing a lot more speed from the inside. And third, number seven, Go So Far for Clement. Should sit a nice stalking trip. Just not sure if she's good enough to handle my top pick. 4-2-7 for me in the third.
5-3-7. Spun Silky gets my top pick. And obviously, we need a little help on the front end with this off the page. So we draw, I think, a comfortable post position. Mm-hmm. I can see Javier Castellano going right over to the hedge, hoping that the rails will still stay down. And it's still firmly packed down in there. For a second, number three, Double the Energy, making only the third start of the year, came back in a victory. And actually, second race off the layoff was rather darn good. And I'm a big fan of the third at a third race off a layoff. And for third is number seven, Gone So Far for Christophe Clement. His horse began the career in France, came to the United States, scored immediately at Keeneland on the poly track. And in the second start in America, sprinting as favorite both times, ran fourth, makes the first start in 2+ months, 5-3-7.
On to the fourth, we've got two-year-old, it's a maiden claimer, the tag's 50,000, sprinting 6 furlongs on the main track.
3-5-9, I've been surprised at the Steve Asmussen paramutuals, let us say, very, very happily.
Sure.
So we're making the third career start after a debut runner-up, maiden special weight, down at Lone Star for the Texas bred, and then lost and came back in stakes company. I don't think very much of that, and now makes the third career start in for 50. Who was it? Did Steve Asmussen have Sis City that Richard Dutro picked
Dutro
off?
Claim and won the Ashland by 100 lengths. That didn't work.
But thinking that, you know, 50,000, it is the Steve Asmussen, but I think this run will be good today for second, number five going out for Ken McBeek. Third start, first time in for a tag. And as much as this game has evolved and the information is quicker and better nowadays, and handicapping has changed, dropping in for a tag is just as attention-getting as it was 35 years ago when I first started doing this regularly. And for third, number nine, Grandpa's King, first-time starter for Carlos Martin. That I think is very intriguing here. 3-5-9.
Biggest drop in racing, would you say? Special weight to claimers, yeah. Especially when you show speed. 9-1-3 for me, and for all Anthony hinted at it a little bit, Grandpa's King for Carlos Martin. Carlos pops with one of these every usually once a meet, and I think last year he did it with a horse named Winekeeper, I believe. And tab the tote on this horse because they usually get bet, and you look up and you're saying he's 3-1 or that kind of thing. Grandpa King to me looks very well meant. The draw's a little bit of an issue, but the work's Whisper Ready. You know, they only paid 20 for this horse, so it's not like they're giving him away by any stretch. He's just probably in the right spot. And as Anthony mentioned, it's not the easiest thing in the world to pop down 50K to claim a horse. So.
No.
You know, they're somewhat could be safe there underneath the one over the speed limit. I don't like the post, but boy, Tony D can't do anything wrong up here. He's winning with 2-year-olds as well. He's underrated first out, so I would think over the speed limit's pretty well met here as well. And for third, Mr. Classic Seneca, who Anthony came up with on top. And I'll mention Steve Asmussen, very slow to start, but he's had a big
yes.
Him, Rosie, and the Brewsters won 3 over the weekend. You know, I don't know what to make of the Prairie Meadows race, but I do know the winner came back to win again, and that's a good sign. It's probably not as good as this field, but, you know, there's some class, so to speak, in his PPs. I would think Mr. Classic Seneca runs pretty well today. 9-1-3 for me in the fourth.
I never asked anybody this, like that, but I say especially for 50, and, you know, you're taking Grandpa's King. They paid 20. You're like,
right.
If you think they're going to really win that day, does that make it even more difficult to pluck down 50? See, if you claim a 75 guy, you're probably thinking, I might have something I could win. Other
right.
thing, though, I'm really wondering if this is really truly a safe zone, because this
yeah.
you don't have this condition if this horse wins
because
to come back.
Then
to.
You, especially with these 2-year-olds, you basically have to run in a stakes race.
Yeah.
It's not like they're carding two L's right now, you know.
They might try and
they
card
might
them.
Try,
they're not filling.
But they're not filling. Exactly right. So that's a really good point. It's a little bit of a poker game in that, yeah, okay, I really like this horse, but he's probably going to win. And then are we going to get our head ripped off in the, I don't know, you know, in one of these races? It's the give and take of that. And
yeah.
I think 50 is that kind of magical number where it's just enough to
And I suspect some of these will be running for maiden claimer 25 in about 3.5 months.
Yeah, I think we could probably do the show the second Thursday in February at the Little A and be talking about someone in for a quarter, without
All right.
a doubt.
We'll take a quick break when we come back. More from Saratoga.
I'm Steve Beck.
And I'm Seth Merrill.
Together, we're Loose on the Lead on Capital OTB, Sundays at 10 a.m. Why should they watch, Seth?
Sit down on Sunday, have a bagel, get some great racing conversation.
Cream cheese only, no jelly. Sundays, 10 a.m., Loose on the Lead, Capital OTB.
The future of online betting is here, and only at the all-new CapitalOTBBet.com. With a newly designed and engineered internet wagering platform, enhanced video streaming, additional funding options, and 3 new individual wagering opportunities, CapitalOTBBet.com delivers a state-of-the-art wagering experience found nowhere else in horse racing. Combine that with our all-new mobile website, you have 2 of the most powerful, innovative, and advanced wagering platforms available today. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
Hey, race fans, head down to the all-new Clubhouse Racebook and get in the game. With live horse racing on more than 250 flat-screen TVs, state-of-the-art wagering terminals, fantastic food and drinks, an amazing Vegas-style atmosphere with seating for nearly 900 of your closest friends. Conveniently located at 711 Central Avenue, right off Exit 5 of I-90 in Albany, the Clubhouse Racebook is the better choice.
I got it.
I'm Mark Cassano. Join me Saturday mornings at 10 for Down the Stretch. We'll inform, analyze, and welcome in the biggest names in racing. So join me Saturday mornings at 10 for Down the Stretch, right here on the OTB television network.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to the Handicappers Report, coming to you live from the backstretch at Saratoga. I'm Anthony Warner, joined by Brian Nadeau. We're up to the 5th race this afternoon, Open Company. Distaffer's maiden special race on the Mellon Turf Course, racing a mile and a 16th.
Yeah, we kick off a $71,000 carryover in the pick six, and one heck of a tough puzzle for me. 6-9-1 for me. I just kind of took the obvious here. Mike Maker draws Castellano, first-time starter. Paid well over $275.
Not for the Ramses.
Not for the Ramses,
not the triumvirate.
Yeah, not the triumvirate, but they paid $275 for a daughter of Harspun, who I love on the turf, that Danzig line. And we talked about this on the show before, Anthony. I don't think Mike Maker gets a reputation as a first-out trainer, but you look down, he's 22%.
It hits you between the eyes.
What the heck's wrong with that? You know, classy teachers would be a tepid pick for me. This is a tab-the-toe kind of race. You know, I wouldn't want to see classy teacher at 11-1. You know, he should be taking money. He should be live. Underneath, I went with the 9 Lady Eli for Chad Brown. Chad's been winning a few with his first-time starters on the turf. I just don't like this post for the two-year-olds. A lot of times we see them run, you know, hell-bent into that first turn, and the outside horses get stacked 7, 8, 9 wide. That would be a worry for me, and that's one of the reasons I went with number one. My senses inside for Grand Motion, a George Strawbridge homebred, the Augustan green and white silks, a daughter of Street Sense out of Crowd Pleaser, who was very good for Augustan years back, and Jonathan Shepherd. I would think My Senses is pretty well meant today. One horse I didn't use in here I wanted to mention.
Can I guess?
Yeah, just go ahead.
Complicated.
No, actually, Scottish Sweetie for Joan Scott, who's 27% second out, 35% on the turf, just ran off with the prestigious Ontario Colleen.
Which, by the way, is for three-year-old fillies.
Up there at Woodbine with a really nice horse over the weekend, who was fifth in the Lake George, up here earlier than me. So I'll throw her out as a little bit of a price chance. 6-9-1 and a real tough cookie for me.
I said last week, you know, coming out of the Arlington Million, I'm not usually that interested in the stories. I'm not like up close and personal type of guy, but I always root for Joan Scott. It's a very small operation, and she does well.
Does very well.
The reason Scottish Sweetie is in my mix for second in there. Complicated to me is the one that I'll be worried about.
Complicated.
The first on the turf for Shug, which has become
over Shug the last and Pips. Yeah.
3 years has
out.
Become. Don't miss the boat here, folks. This is the game. 6-2-1 for me. I'm with Classy Teacher on multiple fronts. The hard spun angle. Down the road, I have Scottish Sweetie for second, making the and for third, number one, My Senses. It's ironic today that we're running the rescheduled turf.
Turf Riders.
Crowd Pleaser won the rescheduled Saranac about 16 years ago.
Okay.
And the only reason I mentioned that was I don't remember too many races being rescheduled in my youth, and that was a rescheduled one.
Especially a flat race.
Yeah, I think
flat
that was
flat stakes race. Okay.
I think John Luke Samin might have had the huge upset victory for the green and white. But 6-2-1, and for me, because the deuce is in my mix, obviously, Complicated the 8 is the one that I've left off that I'll sort of be watching. Now it's Rosie the Pravnik is named on, which is usual direction.
I just maybe, and we saw it Saturday with the Phipps Shug Turfer, maybe I don't want to say a trial run, but we'll be better next out for those connections.
Yes.
I would think. And I would say if Complicated runs well here without winning or does win, look out
it for about 20 years. I thought there are often horses for that operation that use this as practice.
Yeah.
That they were like, get it out,
right.
Go down to Belmont.
Right. I think that's a good point. On to the 6. We've got 3-year-olds and up. It's a conditioned claimer. Non-winners of 2 races since February 1st. A tag, 20,000, 7 furlongs on the main track.
8, 1, 8, and 2 for me, and my top exact is on the outside, folks. The 8 has the second to last post position. Abel Baker, Charlie, Michael Pino, who scored at Saratoga, sends out this runner after an off the board finishing 5th, though very competitively, in a starter allowance over at Parks. We'll see how that transfers to the Saratoga debut. My second pick is the outside most horse, which is the 1A for Bruce Brown. Ancient Rome making the third start after a 16-month layoff. And for third, the other part of the side of the starting gate, number 2, Love to Run for John Kimmel, making the first start since being runner-up down at Belmont July 6th. This will be the third start of the year. And I know John Kimmel's numbers read 11%, but as I've said before, nobody loves statistics as much as me. I just like very good ones. I think he's had a very good meet.
Yeah, his horses have been very live, and you see that with what six underneath finishes. So his horses are.
And I always say, you know, it's. I used to say this about, Brian and I love all sports, except baseball. It's like it's not as good a comparison anymore. But you know, Joe Torre managed the Yankees for all those years, and then you had the manager of the Pirates. My point being, it's not fair to expect the same outcome. So sometimes you have trainers that have a lot of underneath horses.
Right.
Well, the underneath horses might be 8-5, 7-5. Are they out in horse racing? It's easy. John Kimmel's horses have been outperforming their odds.
Their odds.
That means your seconds and thirds are better than some other seconds or thirds when the odds say they should have been maybe performances. Right. That's why 11% doesn't look great off the bat, but if you dig a little deeper, you're like, his horses are outperforming odds. And if I could make any rule that you should get from watching the Handicapper's Report is that's a terrific sign.
Yes.
If it's the same for jockeys.
Mm-hmm.
When jockeys, you know, there's only like 4 or 5 live horses in a race.
In a race.
And there's 7 or 8 terrific jockeys in there.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have a live horse, but your horse runs 4 to 3rd. You watch the guy. I always say they're paying attention on the right part of the track. They're doing
I think if
good
they're
things.
Paying attention, I think that's as important as
you
that.
You know, you're like, you run 5th. Well, I'm on the 8th, you know, live horses.
Right.
So.
And Joe Torre didn't outperform anyone when he was manager of the Mets, so let's not lose sight of that.
Well, I've always
Yankees fans.
I've always said this for Yankee fans, and I love Joe Torre. You know, he's a great human being by all accounts. It's like, look at his record without Mariano Rivera.
Yeah, exactly.
The Mets.
I think I would have won 94 with those Yankees teams. But,
certainly the 98 team.
Yeah, exactly. Well, maybe I'm just a bitter Mets fan anyway. 1-2-6 for me. I went to this other half of the entry. I looked at this race, and for 7 furlongs, I didn't see a lot of speed in here, and that's why I'm just kind of, hopefully we get the old 1-2 to the hoop here. I would think Love to Run is on the lead, and Read the Byline is pressing from the outside, and maybe they scoot clear into the far turn and be done with it. Read the Byline, 3rd off the layoff, clearly bounced in July off that ridiculous number he ran at Belmont in May. I think he's 3rd start of the cycle from a much better draw here. I think he susses out as the outside speed, and I'll mention Anthony's, you know, likes the 1A Ancient Rome, and for good reason, because this horse is, if you look at his form, he's progressing each start. This
Absolutely.
Is the 3rd start off the long layoff, so he gives a lot of backing to the entry. Underneath, I went with Bamada, who I'm pretty sure when Mike Maker claimed this horse for a quarter last time, he wasn't expecting to have to improve off a 7th by over 11 lengths at 2-1. But if you look at his 2 races at Belmont, they're probably going to win this. Can he get back there? I don't know. But 1-2-6 for me in the 6th.
On to the 7th race, we have Phillies Claimers in for 40. Non-winners are 2. Other than on the Melon, Dashing 5.5.
I'm going to try like heck to get Eddie Kay off the duck here.
For the same ball.
3-2-6 for me, Zamquick. And poor Eddie has endured a couple brutal defeats in the past few days. Friday comes to mind when he was about 4 or 5 clear in deep stretch with the 2-year-old filly. I believe the name escapes me, but I'm still not sure how she lost. Zamquick, let's go to the front and forget to stop here. I thought she was the speed of the speed, not necessarily Julien Leperoux's forte. Talk about another with struggling at the meet, but he's put this filly, this mare, on the lead before. And you know what, Anthony? This looks like the old calling up Whisper Hill Farms and say, you mind if I just drop in for 40 out of that 1X because I need a win pretty badly here. Drops in class. Let's hope she hits the front, forgets to stop. They won't be going 44-1 today. Underneath number 2, Lady Luciano. Maybe trips out nicely just off the speed of Zamquick and sticks around for a piece. Benny's Bullet for 3rd, tactical enough to sit a trip for Gary Gullo. Cuts back, which I like, off the 2-turn route on the inner. But I'll go 3-2-6 as we kick off the late pick 4 here.
You know, and one thing I'll say about the 21-3, 44-1, on the Melon, I talked about that. That's where we run our 5.5
furlong
sprints. The rails were up throughout it. The teletimer, trust it if you will.
I agree.
Now I'd like to Julien Leperoux to show the early energy and to drop over to the hedge, because to me, and you saw Joel Rosario do it the first time with the rails down the other day, until they beat up the hedge,
the inside,
the right to it and take our chances this time with Zam Quick. Underneath, I have, because I'm 389 in here, number eight, That's the Boss, gets my pick in here for John Terranova with Taylor Rice in the saddle. Now, John Toscano, here's an example. He's on the duck, but he's had five runners hit the board at Saratoga at this meet. He's only sent out a little bit more than a baker's dozen.
And I'd say the average price is 23 to 1. Okay.
27 to 1 was my number. And for third, number 9, Courageous Karen. Second start of the year. First start wasn't even the practice that we had hoped for. The New York bred was in an entry-level ounce, now in for 40 on the outside, 389.
And she's run very well up here in the past.
Which
you do like to see. On to the eighth, we've got a state bred special weight for fillies and mares, 3 and up. They're going a mile and a 16th on the inner turf course.
9-10-5 for me. Number 9 is Rose Quartz. And Joe Orsino claimed this horse for 40,000, ran the offspring of Rock R10 going 5.5. Now, as good a thoroughbred Rock R10 was, unfortunately, health wasn't his best asset. On dirt, he's a son of Chris S., and he has been a turf influence, I would say, Brian, almost exclusively.
Almost exclusively, which, like you said, is surprising, because what, he won the Malibu going 7.
Right. And just to refresh some people's memory, in 2005, the Breeders' Cup in New York, that St. Liam won and won horse of the year, Flower Alley ran second. I think many people thought Rock R10 was the other horse he scratched out that morning. You know, people forget he was in the Breeders' Cup Classic that year, and I think a lot of people thought he would be the second choice behind St.
He was a freakishly talented horse, but like you said, but he was
to the races.
A little bit of a cripple as well.
And I think, didn't he delay the, what was it, Smarty Jones'
Preakness,
like
right?
Half an hour?
Yeah, something like that. He was a big, giant,
gigantic,
strapping horse,
Are you going to fit in or not? and so I like Rose Quartz. I think a lot fits into this race. Joe Bravo has them out for second, right next door in the starting gate, number 10, Morris Pass. Christophe Clement sends out this runner. Debuted in the spring. That was Memorial Day weekend. On the dirt, came back at Saratoga opening day. Ran well, I think, for the turf debut for the offspring of Warpass. And for third, number 5, Resolutely, going out for Angel Sherpa, making the third start of the year. Came off the Saratoga layoff to return on opening day Saratoga, 9-10-5.
I get a little lucky here and then. I have a best bet, kind of a single in the feature today, not here. I'm gonna buy this race because I have no opinion at all. I came to 210-11 here, Piccolo Flats. The inside draw intrigued me. I thought her two turf races were fine, maybe a little upside here. She made a nice middle move last time, very tepidly. The danger to me and the horse with the most upside, I would think, is a 10 Morris Pass for Clement. But again, she draws outside, only her third lifetime start, only her second on turf. But if she's spotting lengths to the leaders with an outside draw, that's a little bit of a worry. And the same goes for number 11, Lil Zilla, for Tom Morley, who does a very good job with a small stable. But again, the outside post, and there's not a lot of speed here. I'm thinking slash hoping that this is going to be the 18-1 bomb. And the depth of this field is proven kind of, I didn't even come up with your top pick, and like you said, there's nothing wrong with turf for all the reasons you mentioned. Stretching back out, you're going to try to get Joe Arsino off the deck. I'm going to try to get Eddie Kay off the deck. There's a lot of different ways to go in here, and I think it's worth noting, I like that he had a Monmouth rider ride for him in Joe Bravo last time. He sticks around again, and they're only 30% together.
Tremendous
turf rider in general. Joe Bravo, one of the most underrated turf riders in the country, I think.
And he got beat Cliffhanger in the Cliffhanger with
Big Blue Kitten.
And,
Winnie Cause cut back, and the old John's call to Cliffhanger angle. One in 5/8 to 1 mile and 16th, I believe.
Yeah. And I think Big Blue Kitten likes the returns.
Without a doubt.
I think he gets to get in rhythm, and he's athletic enough, and it helps.
Yeah, and I'm just wondering if Chad needed a start in between the Joe Hirsch.
I said this before many times, you know, you see horses running grade one races, and as Brian just said, you might be thinking there's another grade one race on it, and you step into a spot, lower grading, that's fine, but the distance didn't really fit, and you're really wondering, practice.
The old means to an end.
It happens in the game. There are bigger fish to fry. We take a quick break. When we come back, the Late Daily Double.
I'm Jeff Carl. Join me weekdays right here on OTB TV. I'll be reporting from the Saratoga Backstretch, and you can catch me later on 10ABC. I'll give you some spot picks for the next day's racing card.
1922, Babe Ruth debuts with the Yankees. WGY signs on air, Exterminate wins the Saratoga Cup, and Pennell's Restaurant opens its doors for the very first time. For five generations, Pennell's has been preparing delicious Italian food served in a comfortable home-like setting where everyone is welcomed. 92 years of authentic Italian recipes made with the freshest ingredients, and 92 years of the finest classic Italian dishes, all made daily by hand. Pennell's Italian Restaurant, a Saratoga dining tradition since 1922.
Funding your Capital OTB bet account is as easy as 1, 2, 3. 1, easy money. Clearly the fastest and easiest method of depositing funds into your account. Make deposits or withdrawals in just minutes. 2, Green Dot Money Pack gives you instant access to your funds. Green Dot Money Packs are available at thousands of retailers nationwide. And 3, MasterCard Visa. Simply click on the link from the funding page, enter your account information, and fund your account. CapitalOTBBet.com. Log on today.
The Capital OTB Handicapping Challenge Series is back. That's right. The 2014 Capital OTB Handicapping Challenge Series is back, and it's your chance to win thousands in cash and prizes and a seat at the 2015 Handicapping Championship in Las Vegas. This month's contest is the Labor Day Workout on September 6th. So sign up today online at CapitalOTB.com or stop in at the Clubhouse Racebook.
I'm Brian Natto of HorsePlayerNow.com. Did you know that each Monday during the Saratoga Racing Meet, all Capital Bets account holders can earn an additional 1% in their player rewards program and wagering on Saratoga races? For more information, log on to CapitalOTB.com.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, up to the ninth race this afternoon at the Spa. It's the Smart and Fancy, 5.5 on the Melon.
Yeah, my best bet of the day, Anthony. 982 for me, number 9, Stars Above Me for Graham. I believe she's 6-1 on the line. If sign me up, please, right now, because I don't think you're seeing it. But you go back and watch her U.S. debut over the course and distance, where she was in deep, deep water and deep stretch with nowhere to run, and she absolutely exploded late. You know, first start, I guess maybe we could worry about a Euro bounce here, but the fact that she ran that well in her first start in the U.S. for Graham, first Lasix, you know, Graham's a relatively patient guy. So to me, she's a really in a good spot here, and hopefully she sneaks in under the radar. I don't see it, but I'm expecting a monster run from Stars Above, and I like that she's tactical enough to get the jump on my second choice and Matt Graves' top pick, Free as a Bird, because I think Free as the Bird might be a little bit at the mercy of the pace, especially now that she's sprinting 5.5. We saw last time she got run off her feet a little bit, and I'm not saying they're going to go 43-4 today. But she's not as tactical as she was down at Belmont when they were going
I'm
a little
so
bit longer.
I'm not sure they went 43-4
that
the last
day.
Time.
That's very fair. That day. But I think there'll be enough pace where I like Stars Above to get first run on Free as a Bird underneath number 2, Quay, who was very good, good-looking winner earlier in the meet. She's got a little bit of an affinity for this course, 2-for-3 with an exacta finish as well. Second off the layoff for Bobby Rabato. She's going to be a stretch danger. I'm just wondering if she gets run, if she runs out of room on the class rise. 9-8-2 for me in the Smart and Fancy.
I have your top pick and Matt Graves' top pick underneath for me. I'm 1-9-8. One thing I'll say about the one. They take blinkers off this afternoon. I have Cornelia Velasquez on a jockey switch. I'm down on the hedge. I'm thinking I like all three of those things. I still think the hedge on the Melon with the rails down, I'm going to take my chances there. I love Cornelia Velasquez as a finisher. He's on a horse that is going to be a finisher. They take blinkers off, so I'm hoping we get a little relaxation. Mm-hmm. So I got the one on top. Stars Above to me. You know, in the hands of Lester, maybe, you know, off of the European race on June 21st, winning at Saratoga. 39 days later, you think, well, now his arm's got to be exhausted from carrying the luggage, right? But Graham Motion is an excellent trainer. You figure he puts him in here, that this filly, he puts her in here, this filly must be going well. And Joel Rosario on a runner with a running style such as Free as a Bird is nice. And as I said, I'm not usually interested in the backstory too much, but I will say this. And I've never met the woman, but it is wonderful that Elizabeth Villando is still in the horse racing game as an owner. You know, the powder blue and white silks of what was their champion? Fly So Free.
Yeah, no more my era. No biz like showbiz would come to mind. Yeah,
you know, just great to see her
absolutely
still in the game,
without a doubt. All right, let's close it out. The 10 race card. We get to the last. We've got State Bred Maiden Claimers. You ever think you'd see them up here at Saratoga? Fillies and mares. Was the mic on for that? 3-year-olds and up. We're going a mile and a 16th on the melon. The tag is 40,000.
And I'll tell you what. I think for many years at NYRA, they didn't run New York State Bred Maiden Claimers. And that's why horses were 0 for 76.
Right.
But I've said over the last, and I forget what year they started, but let's say last 8th year, this was one of the best conditions to show up because it called off the 0 for 76. Or Smarter Alex might have been the only one that got that high up. And I want, and we've had this discussion off the air when they said there are going to be fewer races here, and I understand quality versus quantity, everything. What I want is 10 horses in a race of very competitive nature,
because
the condition is almost
because in that in the scenario you talked about in the special weights, right off the bat you could take your pen and draw a line through four horses who had not only had no chance of winning, had no chance of running third.
It wouldn't be competitive, so that's fair.
You're going to fill fields with this.
Wonderful, and they're competitive, which is all I want. 9-1-5 for me. My light of the day going out for John Hurtler, who's obviously had a tough meet in offspring of Five Star Day, who, you know, ran in the first grade, won the King's Bishop. That was one of the, you know, titanic performances of the year.
43-2 or something.
Well, and
like
I know they went sub 108 to the eighth hole, and then Forrester was just like, I'm ready now, and just really dismissed him at will. It is the 16th career start. You know, you got to take it for what it's worth. But in this condition now for four of them, and at least they indicate this is water seeking its own level. For second, the rail number one or the hedge. Missed motivation for Gary Siaka. Left the Kathleen O'Connell barn for a guy, me being the guy, who follows Tampa very closely in the winter. Kathleen O'Connell has had an outstanding 2014, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm just wondering if this is a paper thing, you know. And then for third, number five, Kelly's Prize Four, David Dunk, second time in for a tag.
Meaning, I'm not up here, Gary, run this horse for me, kind of a thing?
I get it confused, but I'm like, the horse has done well with her. I mean, why would they? And she's, I know, like I said, I have her stats from when Tampa opened up. She had a tremendous Tampa meet, and she's doing well still. So, I mean, she's not coming up here, I wouldn't think, under any circumstances.
That's what I mean, yeah.
So
okay,
like,
sure. Yeah, I can see it. 5-10-1 for me in a somewhat inscrutable finale. I went with Kelly's Prize. Who has had a nice meet up here is Dave Donk. Dave's done very well, and he got better with King Creesa, who was
five horse field.
Well, five horse field maybe because there were three
pretty good ones.
I don't want to say monsters, but as good three New York breds as you're going to find in there. And so King Creesa was the Sunday rue of my existence. That VE Day was the Saturday rue of my existence. But so we'll maybe try to use Dave here. Kelly's Prize, first time in for a tag on the turf. Was awful up here early in the meet, but it probably, like Anthony mentioned, water seeking this level, which is that'd be the first time I ever say this on the Handicappers Report. Underneath number 10, Lutheran Mist for Jason Service. Stretches out, drops, takes the big drop from special weights. And third, Miss Motivation, who Anthony mentioned, fits like a glove in here. Draw as well. Gary Siaka has got a couple at this meet. That would have been over. And if we put one and a half maybe, or would have been the number.
Yeah.
So the over for Gary, good meet for him. 5-10-1 in the finale for me.
I can tell you, my admiration for Ron Nicoletti goes up because he's on vacation, went to a racetrack.
Well, not only that, but he was tooling around on a bicycle here when he stopped
by
on Saturday.
Ron
must
be on Race Across America.
Yeah, absolutely.
Folks who watch this, he's been really our go-to guy at Gulfstream Park.
Yeah.
He's on vacation. He came to the Saratoga, so two thumbs up. Ladies and gentlemen, it is 1% Mondays, a little gift back on Mondays for our Capital Bet account holders who wager $250 or more in their players reward program. They will get a 1% gift from Capital Off Track Betting. That is now. It'll be on Labor Day, Monday, the final day of this meet. Also talking about the Capital Bets account holders. For new account holders, get it signed up. Bet $50. Capital Off Track Betting will give you $53 to bet more action at Saratoga. And I know for one thing, it's going now through August 31st. So you still have just about one full week for our new account holders. And this afternoon on Capital Off Track Betting, Parks gets us underway. But then Saratoga, Finger Lakes, Delaware, Presque Isle, Northfield, Mountaineer, Yonkers, Mohawk, Australia, A, B, and C. Up next, Seth Merrill, Racing Across America.
You're watching OTB TV, a service of Capital Off Track Betting.